Hello everyone, my name is Calop and welcome to my channel. Now I'm going to get straight to the point with this tutorial because I know many of you have been waiting too long for this. So let's get to it. So for these tutorials, I usually shoot in soft light facing my model with no distracting backgrounds. So in this case, we used a living room. You can use either a phone light, which is really convenient because everyone pretty much has one. I used to do this many, many times, but have since moved on to an actual video light. Now this is the one I use. I really do recommend it because it is really bright and can change colors to any way you want. And this is exactly how I shoot my pictures and how it looks like when I'm viewing through the viewfinder. I love placing my light right above my model's head so that the effects could look realistic. And this is exactly how the photo looks whenever I import it into my MacBook. Of course, the actual light is in the frame and I usually have a separate photo of just the background so that I could easily take it out, but in this case I forgot to. So don't even pay attention to this part, I'm just going to show you what I did. I simply used Content Aware in Photoshop to remove this tool, but I will not be showing this because it's just really bad. I really do not recommend this, so just please ignore it, but I think it is important for me to show you guys how I did it. And then I moved on to frequency separation, which is something I'm also not really going to go into detail about, just because I don't do a good job at it. And so here's the difference before and after. Subtle, but I do think it makes a good change. Thankfully, Diana's skin is already amazing. So now to start with the actual butterflies, I already have the PNG pack just laid out on my file. And the first thing you're gonna wanna do is color the butterflies according to the color of the light that you placed on your model. So then I'm gonna colorize them to be orange and goldish color so that it reflects the light that I have on her hair. And then you're gonna wanna do is select one butterfly to separate it from the rest and leave the pack untouched. Here, I'm just gonna duplicate one of the butterflies using the lasso tool. And then I'm going to transform it and horizontally flip it so that I get it to where I want it to be. Once I have it where I want it to be, I'm going to go ahead and duplicate the layer from the butterfly. And I'm going to put it under screen mode, and then I'm going to Gaussian blur it using filter, blur, Gaussian blur. Now I want to do a very subtle blur, one that only softens the edges of the butterfly. I usually like to build up the amount of blurs, so we're going to do this a couple times. So this is just a subtle blur just for the outlines of the shape of the butterfly. I duplicated that again. I'm going to go back into Gaussian blur, and this one's going to be more spread out so that it makes it look more hazy, more heavenly, more just more magical in general. As you can see, it does look better. It's starting to look even more majestic. I'm going to duplicate it even again. It also all depends on what you prefer, how bright you want it, how intense you want it, how subtle you want it. In me, I never really know. It's just always different every single time. It just depends on what you want. But the screen blur really does help to make it look really magical, and it can pretty much apply to any other shape you want it to be as well. I'm just comparing it, and then I'm going to brighten the base butterfly just because I think it looks better, and I compared it to the other one. And that is all grouped into one butterfly. And we're going to repeat the process to every single butterfly here just so that all of them begin to glow and have the impression that they are emitting some sort of light. Okay, so now with this butterfly, we're gonna screen it, but then blur it. So it's best to use anything that replicates an actual lens blur, and like I know some sort of apps have that, so in this case in Photoshop, I'm gonna use field blur, just because it's pretty simple and it really does a good job at mimicking the actual bokeh effect that lenses create in out of focus regions. So I got to the point that I want it. And then when that's done, now you have an out-of-focus butterfly to work with. So you could duplicate this one as well if you want other out-of-focus butterflies. So now I'm going to go through the process with all the other butterflies. It's really repetitive, so there's no need to go through it one by one. It's really self-explanatory and pretty easy. Now with this butterfly, I've already used it, but I still really like the shape of it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to the transform tool and warp it so that it adds some differentiation amongst the other butterflies and doesn't look too repetitive. But otherwise, the steps are exactly the same. So now I'm just going to crawl by Instagram's 4x5 format just so I know how much room I have and what space I could work with. And don't forget to group your layers. It's always best to keep organized just so things remain less messy. Now it's time to blend some of the parts of the hair. In this case, I'm going to use a curves adjustment layer and bring up reds and yellows. Then I'm going to just brush under where the butterflies are supposed to make contact with my model. And I feel like this touch just makes it a bit more realistic. Okay, so notice how one of her side isn't being lit, yet there's butterflies there. Well, to fix that, get an alternative shot and select the hair and drag it into this shot and blend it in using a mask to make the appearance that there's also being light emitted there as well. I always do this and I always make sure to take so many different shots with lighting at so many different angles so that I'm able to get the same exact look. I think it pulls together the image so well and that's what makes it so convincing. This section in particular probably doesn't apply to you because I don't like how my model was looking to the right. I prefer if she would just look straight at the camera just because I already have a picture of her like that. Okay, I think that looks pretty decent. Now I'm just going to grab the Instagram overlay that I already sized to the Instagram 4x5 dimensions from the original photo. And again, this can be found in the link in the description box. And then after this comes the coloring. And this, of course, is really up to you. I just tend to use gradient maps a lot. I feel like it's my favorite way to do it, along with other methods like select color or the curves adjustment tool, but for this case I just only use gradient maps in the blending mode soft light at very low opacities, probably like from 5 to 20. Now for the last touches, I'm just going to do a global dodge and burn, just highlighting the regions of the face that should receive more of a highlight. And I really love Diana's makeup. She always makes sure to add a highlight and always makes sure to amplify it as well. So I do recommend this doing to your portrait as well, just because it just makes it stand out even a bit more. And then I'm going to do the same thing, but with the shadows and just make them pop more. And That's about it, guys. That's the entire process on how I make each of my 3D Snapchat filters. I hope some of you were able to take something from this video and apply it to your own methods and preferences that fit your style, whether it be on phone apps or Photoshop. But anyways, thank you guys for watching, and especially to my followers who've been waiting so long for my first video. There will definitely be more, definitely better quality, but until then, see you guys on the next one.